Happy Easter.
Happy Easter.
We are so glad you're here this morning. I'm Bert Kite. I'm one of the pastors, and I'm so delighted to welcome you on this grand and glorious Easter morning. If this is your first time here at Castleton, welcome. We are delighted you're here. We hope already you've experienced a sense of hospitality and grace in this place. We are so glad that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. And we hope that when you walk out, you'll be like the group that went out after the early service. They were all saying, wow. And that's our hope for you. If you're at the end of the row this morning, there is a welcome little pad there. And we would invite you taking that and opening up and indicating your presence with the card that's there. And also this morning, if you want to share a prayer concern with us, we appreciate you placing that in the collection plate. You notice all around here this morning, there are all these beautiful flowers, and on the back of your bulletin today, it indicates all those generous givers of those. We want to say thanks to all of you who gave flowers in honor or memory of someone in your life, and thank you for sharing those with us today. Also wanted to say, invite you to join me now and saying a word of thanks. This team is incredible. You are going to be so blessed. If you have socks on, they're going to knock them off. They're going to blow them off. You're going to be so blessed. But would you join me in saying thanks to all these wonderful musicians? Thank you. I'm so grateful that they were willing to get here at 7:30 this morning. I'm not going to ask you how many of you were up at 7:30, but they were here at 7:30, and I want to thank them so much. I want to remind you, next Sunday is going to be a great day for us. We are going to have one of Indiana's best preachers here. His name is Dr. Earl Wilson. He, for 24 years, was the general superintendent of the Wesleyan Church, which is our sister church. In fact, he has throughout the years been involved in very many Methodist organizations as well. Dr. Earl Wilson will be preaching. You may also know him as the father-in-law of our director of operations, Wayne Durr, or you may also know him as the father of the brand new president of Indiana Wesleyan Seminary, Dr. Colleen Durr. Now, yes, Wayne is first gentleman now. His wife is the president of the seminary, so he's learning to do all that humility thing. It's a great thing. We're celebrating with them at her election as the president. Also want to share with you next Sunday, if you've been coming to Castleton for a while and would like to discover a little more about what it would mean to be a member of this church, we want to invite you, no obligation, just come and see. We'll be meeting at the after the 11 o'clock service at right around noon, and we'll be providing lunch for you if you'd like to. If that's something you're interested in, we'd appreciate you calling the office this week and letting us know that. And then finally, we want to invite you to another really incredible musical experience that will happen on April 28th and 30th. Our children, kindergarten through grade 5, in our MAD program, which stands for Arts, thank you. Music, Arts, and Drama, will be sharing the great musical Godspell. They'll be sharing that on Friday evening, the 28th, and then on Sunday morning, the 30th, during the 10 o'clock hour. So put that on your calendar. Don't miss it. It will be a real blessing. Again, we are so delighted that you have come today. And now, if you are able, I invite you to stand for our call to worship.
Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Glory and honor, dominion and power be to God forever and ever. Christ is risen. Alleluia. Please remain standing for our hymn of praise. Christ the Lord is risen today. Amen. Let us now pray together as one voice. God, our Father, by raising Christ your Son, you conquered the power of death and opened to us the way of eternal life. Let our celebration today raise us up and renew our lives by the Spirit that is within us. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, our Son, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please join with me the passing of the peace of Christ, and as we begin to greet one another, we invite the children to come forward for their morning message. The peace of Christ be with you. Let us share Christ's peace with one another.
Any other children would like to join us for the children's message, you're welcome to come down. Good morning, everybody. Today is Easter. It's here. That's exciting. We've had an exciting spring. We've had some beautiful weather. I know a lot of you came to our Easter egg hunt yesterday or went to Easter egg hunts in your neighborhood or other places. It's been an exciting time. Easter is the day we remember that Jesus is alive. But you know, that kind of came as a surprise for even the people who were the closest to Jesus. Even his disciples didn't know that was going to happen. So I wanted to show you something today, because that was kind of like this egg. I brought some eggs with me. Kind of like this egg. When we crack open an egg, what do we have inside? Oh, the yucky stuff, right? The yucky, slimy yolk and the white part, and it's gooey and slimy. That's what we expect to find in an egg, right? But what if I told you that this egg here isn't like the other one? It doesn't have all that slimy stuff inside. Would you believe me? Maybe. Let's find out. Ha! Huh. I was telling you the truth. It didn't have the yucky, slimy stuff inside. That was unexpected, right? And that's kind of like when Jesus was alive. It was unexpected. No one knew that was going to happen, not even those disciples, those close friends of his. So it's really surprising that Jesus was alive and really awesome, and that's why we're celebrating today. You guys got some confetti on you. Are you okay? Okay. I couldn't tell you because it had to be unexpected, just like Jesus being alive was unexpected. Okay, will you all pray with me? Dear God, we thank you for sending Jesus to die for the bad stuff that we do, and that he's alive again. We know that was a miracle, and that was a special thing, and that was your plan all along. We ask that you bless us all this year through. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thanks, guys. You may go sit back with your family or come with me to kids' church. I'm going to move this out of the way.
As the children are going to their appointed places, I want to bring our attention to knowing and being aware that this is a praying congregation, as we all Christians are prayers, but we also want to pray with you and for you and you for us. So in your back of your pew, there is the prayer card. If you fill that out for your celebrations and your concerns, when the offering plate comes, you can put it in there and be assured that we do pray for you and through you and lift your names to God throughout the week. Let us now prepare our hearts in silence. We give thanks to you, redeeming God, for the glorious message that you bring new hope out of despair, resurrection out of defeat, and new life out of death. You give living water so that new life blossoms. You urge flowers to push their way through the dirt to new life. We come this morning placing before you the dead and dried out places in our own lives. We are confident that in your touch, we discover newness of life. Loving God, when we weep, we find our eyes are dried by you because of the hope that you bring and the comfort you give us in our sorrow. Wise God, you know our doubts, our fears, and our failures that we bring to the tomb on Easter morning. And yet we find forgiveness. And through your Spirit, you nurture the small growth of hope, the courage and faith that comes with us in us. You have sought us. And this morning, on this day of Easter, we experience your grace. So our misdeeds, our mistaken attitudes are all reformed through your grace. We bring before you the places in our lives and in our world where despair reigns and seems to be unchallenged. We agonize over the concern we have for our country and our world. Aggressions and resentments seem to be coming to a point of peril for all of us. Lord God, point us toward actions, however small, that lead us to a more hopeful future for ourselves and our world. The resurrection makes possible for our lives to be completely changed. So in our weakness, you bring strength, and in our despair, you bring hope. And we find that we are able to love beyond our frustrations. So because you are with us, we gain courage, choosing life as we move through time. You've raised Jesus from the dead. Raise us to new life day by day. So now, we lift up in a united voice the perfect prayer taught to us by Jesus, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
It is now time for our offering. That is right here at Castleton United Methodist Church. It is our tradition to give out a little bit of a shout as a reminder in Scripture that we are called to be joyful givers. So at this time, we will give of our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. And I do want to remind you that electronic giving is an option, and the information is on the screens. And any of the loose change that you offer into the offering plate goes out to our Fishes and Loaves funds to help those in need that comes to this congregation. So as the ushers come forward, again, we will now take up our tithes, our gifts, and our offerings. Thank you.
cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree. His body and drenched in tears, they laid him down in Joseph's tomb. The entrance sealed by heavy stone. Messiah slipped, and all of
we
thank you, and please be seated. Got all these egg pieces up here, all this glitter. Isn't that wonderful? He is risen. He is risen. I want to share the story with you of John's account. All four of the Gospels talk about the resurrection. Today we are hearing it from John's version, from the 20th chapter. Listen. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and I do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple, meaning John, outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down and looked in and saw that the linen wrappings were lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, always the impetuous one, following him, and he went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, John, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand that the scripture, that he, meaning Jesus, must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and one at the feet. The angel said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Mary said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know it was Jesus. Jesus said to Mary, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you looking for?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and saw that it was him, and she spoke to him in Hebrew, saying, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Then Jesus said to her, "Do not hold on to me, because I have not yet ascended to our Father. But go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is God's word for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Call him the Lord.
Thank you, and please be seated. Wow, I told you they were going to knock your socks off today. Isn't that wonderful? Well, one of my family's favorite comic strips is Family Circus, and I bet there's probably a lot of Family Circus fans here. One year at this great season of Easter, the children were coloring Easter eggs on Easter morning, and they had been doing that, and then Dad was putting away the Easter dyes, and Billy, one of the boys, was talking to his little sister, Dolly, and he pointed to the Easter eggs that they had just colored, and he said, "These, now sister, these are not the real Easter eggs. The chocolate ones are the real Easter eggs." And can I get an amen to that? Yeah, yeah. Didn't you love it when they said dark chocolate could be good for us? Boy, what a great rationalization. Well, I want to talk today about, throughout this whole season of Lent, we've been talking about resurrection in the context of forgiveness. And by that I mean forgiveness bringing new life to you. Forgiveness bringing new life. I met them when I first went to that church. He had been a retired meat butcher for Kroger, and she had worked 35 years at community hospital as a receptionist in the surgery waiting room, greeting everyone with her lovely way just as they entered to face surgery. Her name was Betty. Betty was an amazing lady. She put her clothes out. I don't know why she told me this one day, but she said, "You know, I plan ahead." And she said, "On Sunday afternoon, I put all of my outfits together for the whole week." I went, "Wow, I'm really impressed. Somebody's that, maybe some of you here do that. I don't do that," but she did every day. She was a very organized person, and her husband, Bill, was a very methodical. He was a good Methodist. He was very methodical, had a very set rhythm every day for his life. After I'd been their pastor for some time, they one day invited my sweetheart, Deb, and me to their house for lunch. It was wonderful. She got out all this beautiful china and her crystal and a beautiful tablecloth, and we sat down to have a wonderful lunch. And we just thought they'd invited us there to have a great time. But finally it came out in a conversation. Betty said, "Well, Pastor, we've invited you and your wife here today because we want to talk about our daughter. She's been estranged from us for many years. And we just need to talk about it." So Deb and I listened to their cup of suffering, if you will, as she poured it out. They hadn't spoken. They had not communicated. They had not written. They lived 5 minutes apart here in Indy. But they had not communicated in many, many years. In fact, I don't know exactly how many. She did tell me that the estrangement had been going on since their grandson, who was then 24, was a small child. So it had probably been the better part of 2 decades when they had been estranged from each other. And after that, I began to pray about that for a long time. And then Easter came that year. And as she went out, not Bill, her husband, but as she, Betty, went out that day, she said, "You know what? I finally figured out what Easter is." She said, "It's about resurrection." "Yeah." But she said, "No, I mean, it's about new life for me. I'm going to call Janet," that's her daughter's name. She said, "I'm going to call Janet and just wish her happy Easter and that I love her." I said, "Sounds great to me." So she called. She came back the next Sunday and she said, "You never guess what happened." "Right. Did she hang up on you? Did she tell you where to go? And it isn't the place where we celebrate resurrection in heaven?" "No." She said, "Oh, Mom, I've been missing you too." And then later that week, Janet called me and she said, "Pastor, I have a strange request." Jackie does this a lot. I haven't done it that many times. But she said, "Pastor, could you meet with Janet and us as we try to renew our relationship?" And I'm happy to say, not long after that, God's timing is so awesome. Not long after that, Betty became very ill, and it wasn't long before she had a 6-week, from the time she was diagnosed until she died, was 6 weeks, a very quick illness. But in that time, Janet and her mom and dad reconciled. And then after Mom's death, Janet took care of Dad for the rest of his life. You see, she was an only child. That is the Easter story. That God can take nothing, and just when we think there is no hope, God makes a way. Just when you think death is final, just as those disciples came to the tomb that early morning. You know, I've always loved this. I've always been a great fan of women, you know. I love women. I love one woman passionately. I just want to make that clear. But I love women. You see, it was the women who were the faithful ones who came to the tomb. It was the women who went back and told the disciples, "We have seen the Lord." It was these faithful ones who came and said to all of who would hear, "He has risen. He has risen." And I bet there are some of us today that need an Easter experience like Bill and Betty and Janet did. I bet there are some of us that need a new beginning, a new hope. Because you see, it takes God to do that, though, and it's in God's time and not our time. I confess that Bill and Betty's story is very powerful for me, because at my house, we have a child who is estranged from us. And it's been now 6 years. And we keep praying, "God, in your time," we believe it will happen, "God, in your time." And Bill and Betty's story and the 2 decades of it is kind of a reminder for me. But like that, those early disciples, God transforms your expectations and shatters your expectations. They came to that tomb and they thought they were going to see a dead body there. But instead, they saw he was not there. He had raised. And his raising means our raising. His death means our life. His sacrifice means our freedom. His hope swallows up our hopelessness. His grace is so amazing. Long after we think anything can happen, God shows up. Can I hear an amen to that? God shows up when you least expect it. God shows up and can transform what seems like a broken, hurting, and no solution problem. And God shows up and makes everything new. Everything new. I love the way Harold Ivan Smith said it in his wonderful little poem. He said, "Lord, I need an Easter so authentic that it would be frightening. Could someone come to my tomb? And discover that the one who was mourned has risen, and that my tomb too is empty." That's the hope, that Christ will come Christ is the ultimate hope, dear brothers and sisters. There'll come a time when you think you can rely on everything, and you have the faculties, you have the intellectual acumen, you have the heart and passion, but it will not happen. Because you know what I know, that we live in an evil world. Last Sunday, Palm Sunday, 45 Coptic Christians murdered in churches in Egypt. In our city, last year, 147 homicides. More than the Wild West ever was a bang, bang, shoot 'em up place. Our culture, our city today is broken. More than so many other problems that happen, like those who die from drug addiction, or those who give up on life and choose to end their lives by taking their lives. You see, people, their life ends not because they die. Their life ends because they have no hope. Because without hope, dear sisters and brothers, you cannot live one day. You cannot live one day. You can go maybe 2 weeks without food. You can go maybe 3 to 5 days without water, but you cannot live a single day without hope. And Easter is God's message of hope. Easter is God's yes to the world's no. Easter is that by which we are invited to walk into that empty tomb and say, He is not in there, He's here. He's here. He's here with us. His love and His grace are in this place. And to the dead and decaying parts of my life and your life, He says, Behold, I make all things new. I make all things new. God's grace, God's love, God's blessing do that. Nothing else does that. God makes it all new. The founder of our church, the Methodist Church, was a guy named John Wesley. And Wesley had long been studying the faith, had long been praying the prayers day after day, week after week, year after year, grown up in a Christian home where his father was a pastor. His mother was one of the most devoted saints that has been known in Christianity. How many of you learned Greek and Latin at your mother's knee? John Wesley did. She was an incredible woman. But despite that faithful family from which he came, and all the blessings of being with 7 brothers and 2 sisters. John Wesley came to the point, he was 35 years old, had been through Oxford, had studied, had learned, had been ordained as a pastor in the Church of England, had preached untold thousands of sermons. But most of the places he went, they would say, Mr. Wesley, come not back here. We don't need your judgment anymore. You see, John Wesley knew all about judgment, but he had not experienced God's grace. And so finally, after a horrendous experience, you know, it's not a proud thing for me to admit that the most horrendous experience in the founder of Methodism's life happened the only time he came to America. But it's true. But as he was going back to London, he saw a group of Christians who were so faithful and courageous. And when the ship nearly wrecked in the North Atlantic in January of 1738, John Wesley was fearful of death like all the rest on the ship, except that little group of Christians that were gathered over in the keel and praying and singing God's praises. And he went to their leader and he said, I want what you have. And the leader said, when you get back to London, look up Peter Baylor, a Moravian brother, a German Christian. And so Wesley began a continuous dialogue with him through letters and conversations over the next several months. And then finally, in May of that year, of 17 and 38, he came to a breaking point in his life. And he said, I can't do it on my own anymore. I can't do it on my own anymore. And he went to a place he didn't want to go. I wonder how many times we go to places we don't want to go, only to discover that there was a great blessing. I'm not going to ask you how many times you've come to church with that. You didn't really want to come, but you came only to discover God was here. God showed up, and God blessed us. Well, that was Wesley's experience. And so that night, as he went to a little gathering of Christians in the heart of London, he wrote, I gathered about 8:45 with a group of Moravians, and one of them was reading Luther's preface to the Epistle to the Romans, when suddenly I felt I did trust in Christ. Christ alone for my salvation, and an assurance was given me that my sins, even mine, had been forgiven. And Wesley would, for the rest of his life, say that that day had turned him, had transformed him. He needed an Easter so real that God could come and take him out of his tomb. Well, maybe that's where you are today, dear friends. And I want you to know that loving Lord is here for you. He's no longer stuck in the ground in a grave. He has been raised, and his raising means your forgiveness, and his raising means we can have new life. New life. And that's not just the preacher's hyperbole. I mean it with all my heart, that God can change us, can help with the reconciliations of relationships, can give you hope if you're so discouraged that there's not a job on the horizon that you know you need, or that you are so discouraged because one of your kids is so mad at you they won't talk. Or you're so discouraged because your job looks like it's going to soon end. You fill in the blank for you. But what I want you to know is that God shows up. God gives you new life. God gives you hope. It was said so well by Rita Snowden. This is something I've shared every year that I've preached on about Easter, and if you're here next year, you'll hear me quote it again, because it, to me, speaks so well. She said, hang out your hallelujahs. The Roman guard is gone. The final enemy, death, is defeated. The man of life walks again, comforting the troubled, healing the sick, forgiving sinners, spreading his gospel through the lips and lives of those made new. Hang out your hallelujahs. Can you say that with me? Hang out your hallelujahs. And all of God's people shall together say. Now, as we prepare to sing our final song, and just after that will be a benediction, and then following the benediction will be our traditional hallelujah chorus. So if toward the end of the next song you would like to come and join the choir in singing the hallelujah chorus, come on up the sides, and you're more than welcome.
Would you please stand?
You are good and your mercy endureth forever.
Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. He rules the heavens and the nations from generation to generation. We worship you.
Hear now the benediction. Because the tomb is empty, your life can be full. So go into every place and every day as people, Easter people, brimming with the love of God. Be graceful in the spirit, hopeful in work, faithful in deed. Live for the risen Christ as Christ lives in you. Alleluia and amen.
Yeah.